Well, now we're getting someplace. The seminar is making progress. What we're seeing here is that we
I love your condescension. It's hilarious. Go ahead, finish up.
That's a video dating back to 2011 when Cenk was hosting an MSNBC show and happened to interview Peter Morici, a libertarian economist. And lucky for us, Morici just penned an op-ed for Market Watch that basically tried to make a point that, you know, we're gonna need to work harder, we're gonna need to work longer to sustain the economy, and that's a great thing. Don't believe me? Well, before we get to more fun clips featuring Cenk debating him, let's get to the op-ed itself. The headline is, Americans may have to start working younger and retire older. That might be a good thing.
Ugh.
So
already a disaster.
So he said that might be a good thing, Cenk. Anyway.
Oh yeah, of course. For corporate America.
Exactly. Yeah. So he says, you know, going forward, China will suffer from fewer workers, fiscal challenges to support more seniors, and also higher capital costs as resources are diverted. And as a result, he writes, China for years has been moving up the technology ladder with strengths in green energy, computer chip making, and now a world-class electric vehicle industry. Such higher value activities mean that China's economy can still grow with fewer workers. So that's mild, right? But he's setting something up. He continues to write, Western governments will be further challenged to finance investments to mitigate climate change, infrastructure, investments in R&D and defense without imposing declining living standards on the working age population through taxes or inflation. Textbook policy remedies, from subsidies to support more children to government financed and industry mandated childcare, haven't worked.
Made it up.
Wait, no. Not only did he make it up, what childcare? Like what childcare? What are you talking about?
Well, the only thing that I thought the same exact thing when I read that, and I was like, wait, where's your facts for that, Mr. Professor, right? You just asserted it with no facts to back you up whatsoever. And I was like, the only thing I could think of that he's talking about is maybe the child tax credit that they did in the first COVID relief bill under Biden.
You know,
but hold on.
One year. No. I'm so sick of people bringing that up as if it was like a long lasting progressive policy that Biden accomplished and we should all give him a round of applause. It was 1 year, 1 year.
I know, but the reason people bring it up and try to give him credit is because it was a stunning success.
No, it was a success,
right,
but it expired.
But my point is that Morici's saying, no, they definitely don't work. What do you mean? The 1 year we did it, everybody loved it. And it helped the economy. There's now lower unemployment than there's ever been. So what's your evidence that government programs to help people with childcare don't work? You just made it up.
So he also discussed how critical technological advancements and modern financial markets have been spurring productivity and economic growth. But now that slowing population growth poses a threat to wealth, Peter thinks the answer is to start workers young, even younger, and never let them stop. So here's what he writes. To raise the half of humanity living in poverty with the requisite goods and energy, avert or mitigate flooding coastal cities and severe weather, and sustain living standards in developed economies, two things appear clear. People will have to work longer, and a smaller population consuming fewer resources will be a welcome development. Okay, I'm gonna read that again. I want you to like really absorb what he's arguing here, okay? Two things appear clear. People will have to work longer, and a smaller population consuming fewer resources will be a welcome development.
Yeah. So look,
you're gonna have to work longer for less. That is what he's saying there, right?
Yeah, well, he's definitely saying you gotta work longer. Back to the mines. 67 is too young to retire. That's literally his claim. Look, if you notice, he keeps going back to climate change and clean energy. He does it throughout the entire article, like as if he cares. Like if you put together a climate change proposal, I would be shocked if he wasn't massively opposed to it. So he's trying to like, it's such an amateur way, but it's like from the old school, from the 1990s. Well, actually through the 2010s too, when I debated him, where he'd be like, oh, I am doing this for the youngs, for the youths. Oh, I hear they care about climate change. And if you care about climate change, you're gonna wanna work till 80. Wait, what? Okay, total turn there. No, one thing has nothing to do with the other, and I don't believe you care about climate change at all.
So then he goes on to say, like, you know, these annoying progressives, they keep bringing up this issue about how not everyone has a similar job. You know, some people, they're you know, pushing paper, they're sitting at desks, they're comfortable, it's cushy, there's not a whole lot of hard labor. There are other people who do difficult manual labor, right? Construction jobs, that always comes to mind. And so how are you gonna ask construction workers to work even longer? I mean, it really does take a toll on the body. Let's go to graphic 6 here. He doesn't offer any solutions, let's just be clear. He doesn't offer any solutions, but he does juxtapose American culture to Japanese culture by writing, the Japanese already have faced the problems of an aging population and declining workforce. Japan has sustained per capita incomes by accepting immigrants from poorer nations, which I have no problem with. I think that's actually a good thing. Working smarter, redesigning physical tasks so that older workers can do them.
Oh my God.
And flexing their superior acumen with robotics.
So, I mean, he's literally arguing we should do like Japan, make it easier for older people
for
to work.
For elderly people, yep.
Right, and drive them back into the offices because the corporate machines
or work sites
need more fodder, okay? So remember, we've been showing you on the show, Sarah Huckabee Sanders did it in Arkansas, and many other Republicans are now saying lower the age of child labor in America so we drive the kids back into the factories, right? Mm-hmm. And now they're saying also raise the age so you have to work into the 70s. Now we're not gonna pay you well. No, that's not the answer, okay? We're always gonna make it so that you could barely subsist, right?
And that's a good thing.
All the way into your 70s and 80s, and that's such a good thing like Japan did. We're gonna bring in the robots and they're gonna re-engineer your work so that you could still kind of do it when you're like 90.
But what about mental decline? Because that's something else that people unfortunately experience as they get older. And here's what he has to say about that. Until now, treatments have focused on removing plaque from the brain after dementia begins, but medical researchers are closing in on the equivalent of statins, which often avert heart disease before it can develop for the brain. We could take these medications in our 50s to keep us working at near top level well into our 70s. He writes this with a straight face. By the way, this is his solution to elderly people experiencing mental decline who might have to still work because our economy is so disgustingly rigged. He responds to that with healthcare. Drugs, you gotta take drugs. In a country where our healthcare system is broken, it's broken. It is astronomically expensive to get the healthcare that Americans need, especially as they get older. But he's like, just take some statins, you know?
To be fair to my old friend, Professor Marici, there is someone still working with dementia in their 80s, that's Senator Dianne Feinstein.
She should have taken some statins.
And so, well, he doesn't really care as long as she votes for the corporate agenda, which she does. She does. But guys, this is a twofer, and that's why this is particularly this episode. One, you're never gonna get a break. The corporate machines need you to work, they will literally work you to death, okay? But two, that also means we're not gonna give you Social Security, okay? Because we already spent it in the tax cuts for the rich, for the defense contractors, all the subsidies we gave to the oil companies.
There will be a civil war.
It's gone, it's gone. What we're gonna do is we're just gonna take your Social Security and make you work late into your 70s. And we care about solving dementia, not for you, but so that
we'll
have more widgets, more of you widgets to plug into our corporate machines.
That's exactly right. So if you didn't already think that this guy was awful, I remember booking him on the show a lot back in the day when I was a guest booker. These are like early years of TYT. He has gotten into many debates with Cenk for obvious reasons. So let's go back to his debate with Cenk specifically on MSNBC, which was about the American, about a poll showing just how progressive Americans are on these economic issues. So Cenk, in the context of that interview, showed this poll or showed this on the screen. Let me show you what it says, what America wants. So according to that poll, 55% said that it was totally unacceptable to cut unemployment benefits. 56% said it was totally unacceptable to cut Head Start. 59% said it was unacceptable to cut student loans. So you can see it, list goes on and on. 77% were against cutting Social Security. all of this makes sense. Obviously, that's from 2011. The results haven't changed much. Most Americans want economic prosperity. Cutting these programs is the antithesis of that. So that is what they were debating about. Let's watch more of the video.
You know, I look at that poll and I think, God, can it get any clearer? Am I missing something? It looks like the American people are pretty darn liberal based on those numbers.
I think you're missing a lot. Americans tend to be more moderate than leaders of either party will acknowledge or than either Fox or MSNBC will embrace.
Professor, I'm going to challenge you with facts. The facts I just gave. A great majority of us want to raise taxes on people making over 100,000 because we're in a real budget mess. Why don't we do it?
Well, now we're getting someplace. The seminar is making progress. What we're seeing here is that we
I love your condescension. It's hilarious. Go ahead, finish
up. Well, I'm trying to bring you along now. What we're seeing
here is that I showed you the numbers. You haven't shown anything yet. Go ahead.
No, I've shown quite a bit. You just don't want to acknowledge it.
Economist Peter Morici, thank you for your time.
Thank you for having me.
I appreciate it. Even though you've been completely and utterly wrong,
as you have not supported the facts at all.
Okay, but my favorite part of that interaction, Jake, was when he tried to do a gotcha on you and didn't do his homework and really fully understand who he was talking to. So let's just watch that quick moment and then you can comment.
The Republicans spent millions upon millions of dollars that they raised from incredibly rich people so that they could do ads pretending to be on the side of the American people. What did they campaign on? We showed it earlier in the show. They said, oh, we're going to create jobs. They come in, they don't create jobs at all. They trick the American people. You know that in elections, it turns out commercials make a difference. They do political spending.
That's why Barack Obama can raise so much money on Wall Street.
I agree.
Well, I mean, Wall Street supports Democrats for a reason. They get their way. I mean, the Democratic Party is the party of Wall Street.
Okay. Look, I actually agree with that, but then you're agreeing with me that they're too conservative. All right, Professor, we gotta go.
Take care.
No, but he's saying they're the party of Wall Street. That means they're too conservative. He's like, oh, that's ridiculous.
I know.
But you just said it, okay? So, all right, my favorite part of all that was two things that happened behind the scenes. And this is interesting. Well, actually, one was public, another one was behind the scenes.
Ooh.
So Mediaite writes an article about that all the way back in 2011. So that's a dozen years ago, okay? And I don't know if the writer is right wing or just an establishment person. And remember, a dozen years ago, the progressives were not anywhere near as strong as they are now. And almost everyone in media was like super establishment,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
And so they like lit into me saying like, this was uncivil. How dare he, right? And the last line was sarcastically civil with an exclamation point. Like, they're so funny. They think that if you bring on these guests that are lying, the right thing to do, the civil thing to do is just let them lie.
Yeah, no, no, totally, right? Absolutely.
And so now when they say like Caitlin Collins didn't challenge Trump enough, that's why it's hilarious. Because no, in cable news, the etiquette for decade after decade was don't challenge any of the guests. And everybody's supposed to have it like an orgy of agreement. So now the behind the scenes thing, when that guest came on, our producers booked him thinking that he agreed with me. And it turns out he didn't. And we had what I thought was a super fun and interesting exchange, right? My executive producer comes out after the show and lights into the booker. And he's like, and Cenk, don't worry, we'll never have him on again. I'm like, why?
Oh my God, come on.
Why? That was an interesting discussion.
No, that's
not
allowed.
I like having him on.
Not allowed.
Right.
No interesting discussions.
Isn't that interesting? So that's at MSNBC. No, everyone has to agree, just like at Fox News.
That's incredible. That is incredible. All right, well, check out our YouTube library of videos to watch other exchanges that Cenk had with Peter Morici, because I did book him a lot. And look, to Morici's credit, he was down to debate. He would come on the show knowing full well what your stance was, knowing that he was walking into a debate.
That's why I didn't mind him at all.
Yeah.
And an exchange of ideas, especially when you're right, helps completely.
Yeah.
You don't want an exchange of ideas when you're wrong and you don't have the facts on your side. So I don't mind it at all, and I love to debate people that are wrong.